Oh, what's up, everyone? We got people joining today. Thank you for coming. Excited to kick off the session.
A lot of familiar faces here, or names at least that I see on LinkedIn, so that's awesome.
Yeah, throw your video on if you'd like. We always love to see your faces and we want to keep this interactive. So feel free to drop your questions as we go. We have a couple topics that we'll kick off with, but love keeping it interactive like the old school DGL days. All right, you want to kick us off, Evan, with our first topic? We'll get going. We got people coming in, but we'll get started and let people in as they continue to join.
For sure. I think that, we are the whole idea of this is around 2025 planning, really just setting motion of how we are working with our clients, how we're thinking about different demand strategies, what's working, what's not. So really bringing this conversation, like Megan said, just to be an authentic engagement between audience members, as well as just like open-ended questions. We brought Ciara and Matt to the conversation. So I think we should just kick it off. We've got a few questions throughout that we'll kind of just like gauge and go back and forth. But as you have questions, please, like Megan said, drop them in the chat. I think, from a first, the first question I always have, and it's the fact that we have what 9 Tuesdays left this year blows my mind. 10 Mondays. So the year's going quick. But I'd love to open it up to the team here. Looking back at 2024, what are some of the top 2 to 3 trends you've seen kind of impact B2B SaaS specifically, that performance relatively good or bad? Just like what are trends you're seeing with clients? How are you getting into the market?
All right, I'll get us started. So I'd like to sort of zoom out a little bit when thinking about this question, and I think it's kind of important to look back over the last 4 years and really understand how the B2B market has shifted in a lot of really pretty significant ways, actually. We of course had the pandemic in 2020, and that was a massive shift in terms of just real life. Everything basically went from in person to online overnight. And then in terms of the B2B SaaS ecosystem, we saw a pretty significant shift in the acceleration and the adoption of digital strategies. However, at the same time, we were really at this beginning of this juncture where the digital strategies that worked really well from the early 2000s up till 2020 were beginning to lose effectiveness. There were new emerging approaches and tactics that were becoming more effective, but most companies hadn't recognized this or hadn't made any changes to their strategy. And the pandemic effectively accelerated and injected a pretty insane amount of money into the digital marketing landscape. So you had, what I call almost the COVID boom with a lot of SaaS companies, a lot of VC funding was injected in the market, a lot of companies were just over-investing in growth. Top-line growth was the most important thing over everything else. And people were just dumping money into paid advertising because they thought this is the quickest way to grow, right? Almost treating it like a coin-operated machine. And at the time, Refine Lab specifically, we were posed as a digital media agency. We were helping companies spend that, but we also had our unique point of view on how marketing should be executed. So we were really trying to be at the forefront of that and to shepherd that change. We see this insane growth spike across the B2B SaaS ecosystem into 2021 and the beginning of 2022. And Q2 of 22 is when we start to see everything kind of the foundation gets a little shaky, right? And things, the house of cards starts to crumble a little bit. We start to see VC funding dry up. We see startups running out of money. As we all know, there were just a lot of layoffs in the ecosystem. And there was this market effectively forced this pretty significant correction. And the correction was growth at all costs without any regard for unit economics is just not acceptable anymore. And that's where the people that were able to pivot and adapt survived. And then there were those that were not able to. And many companies went under or closed or downsized significantly over that time period. What's really interesting is when you look at B2B SaaS companies, I've noticed a pretty significant difference in terms of more mature companies, 100 million ARR plus, and then sort of the growth stage startup. So when you talk about these more mature companies, they had a relative success. They had a pretty significant moat going into this tumultuous time of, you know, 2020 to 2022. They were able to ride out the highs and the lows and survive without much of an issue because of that strong foundation. However, this segment of companies, even today, still are deploying these digital strategies from the early 2000s and are not necessarily feeling that sense of urgency to change. What I'm beginning to notice now in 2023 and 2024 is those companies are beginning to start to see things like efficiencies that were hidden before because of their relative success begin to come to the surface. Overall declining ROI on all marketing and sales investments. They're finally seeing the data that's showing that lead gen campaigns, display advertising, these tactics that are generally accepted almost that just aren't as effective, they're starting to see that in the data. And they're more open-minded than ever at this point to begin making those types of changes. I view that as a huge positive. A little late to the game, but let's go. And because of the size of these organizations, you can't underscore the challenge of the change management process that's ultimately required for those companies to actually navigate that successfully and not only, you know, begin to grow again, but begin to grow at the rate that they were previously and get back into a place of dominance in their particular, you know, industry. Growth stage startups, it's a whole nother set of challenges because most early startups that you encounter today, they don't have to change from doing things the old way into the new way. And the challenges that they have are really fundamental business challenges. Do you actually have a product or service that the market needs? Have you actually identified core positioning and messaging that actually resonates with your buyer? Are you even clear on who your buyer is? They almost jump to, oh, I understand modern demand. I can build a founder brand. I can start a podcast. I can, you know, execute paid social. So it's like they understand the tactics that work today, but jump to execution of those tactics without ensuring that their core business fundamentals, like their actual product and service, their positioning and their business model are actually ready to scale. So there's two separate challenges for these types of businesses today. And I think depending upon what type of company you are, the biggest trend that I'm seeing again for these larger ones is actually waking up to the fact that they need to make this shift and beginning to prioritize and begin to make those changes, recognizing that that it does not happen overnight, that this is a 1 to 2 year endeavor to make all of the changes throughout the organization in terms of programs and headcount and goal setting in order to continue to survive for the next 5, 10, 15 years. And then you have this other segment where, although I would say very savvy to what it means to build a modern demand engine, are not giving the requisite attention to like the core business fundamentals. And I mean, what I tell people, you know, I have sales calls every day with companies. And when I talk to an earlier stage company, it's like, before you jump to like your Google Ads or your LinkedIn, you know, advertising strategy, there's some other stuff here that needs to be figured out. Like this is crucial before any of those digital marketing tactics are actually going to drive the results that you want. So I was a little more long-winded than I anticipated, but That's what I've been seeing at sort of a high level. But I'd love to kick it over to my friend and one of our best strategists here at Refine Labs, Matt Sciannella. Would love to get your take on the same question, you know, from your perspective and get us more into the weeds with some of the things that you're seeing and all the great work you're doing with our customers.
Yes, I think one of the things I'm seeing a lot of is just paid search continues to get a lot harder and a lot more competitive. And you really have to look at paid search investments at the product level, particularly for non-branded, and figure out whether you're spending the right amount of money to get there, if you're spending too much. And to me, like the end all be all metrics is, first off, get that level of measurement from the ad platform into the MAP and into the CRM and map that from the contact to the opportunity to the close one. And then CAC and payback period to me are like the end all be all metrics there. And like, you need to have a line of sight into acceptable CAC and payback metrics, basically at any level of the organization you can get. If you're in-house, you should understand it at the go-to-market motion all the way down to the program itself. And to me, like, non-branded search is just incredibly competitive for some of these markets where you're spending like $150 a click before you can even have a chance to swing and get an inbound lead to qualify and get through your funnel. So to me, like, it's really saturated there, and you got to really, when you can see that you're running into a super competitive market, you really got to try some outside the box stuff, challenging even some of our own POVs and frameworks. We're finding ourselves challenging on some of those things, even in some instances, like things that I do outside of our own playbook, like running small, broader phrase match campaigns in uber competitive industries with like a really narrow keyword set with a super aggressive negative strategy, just to like see if I can get lower cost per clicks and still get a requisite number of inbounds, and then see if that progresses all the way through the funnel. Like, so sometimes if it's uber competitive for you for a non-commercial or for a commercial non-branded high intent term, you got to think outside the box, stuff like that with your limited budget. One other thing that I'm seeing a lot of, and this has been a feeling that I've largely had for about 6 months now, is just, I feel like LinkedIn has become a very saturated ad channel for B2B SaaS. Like, everybody and their mother's cupcake company runs LinkedIn B2B advertising. And I just think like we are stuck in an advertising duopoly as B2B SaaS that we need to shake ourselves out of fundamentally as a profession. I'm looking a lot more into like other ways to get in front of my ICP and my key demographics. I'm looking at demand side platforms. I'm looking at out of home advertising. I'm looking at things that are, I can do other programs that are maybe ABM friendly as well. But like, everyone is running LinkedIn. LinkedIn is the best B2B advertising platform that exists. I'm not going to deny that. But should that be all of your brand awareness spend? I'm not sure I could recommend that with full confidence. Even looking at, there are tools coming out. If you can't afford a metadata, there's tools like Primer out there that are a little bit more budget friendly for you to do Facebook and Instagram enrichment with B2B level targeting. So just get outside of the duopoly, in my opinion, of LinkedIn and Google ads. And just, not everybody spends time on LinkedIn. We all do here. That's part of the reason why we're all here, because you all saw our organic promotions and our email. But guess what? Like, I mean, go talk to your friends who are outside of SaaS and ask them how much time they spend on LinkedIn, and you will be surprised how few of them spend more than maybe an hour a week on it. So find other ways to target and find your target audience in ways that are going to be harder to attribute, unquestionably, but will probably be more effective in getting in front of them with a more resonant message. So that will be that's my spiel on that.
Coming in hot, Matt. I love that.
I love it.
Ciara, let's hear what you got. I'm sure you got some opinions too.
Yeah, I do. Also, hi everyone. I am new to the B2B Roundtable and kind of Demand Gen Live community. My name is Ciara Hopkins. I'm VP Demand at Refine Labs. It's really nice to see all of you and meet all of you. I loved, Megan, what, you know, both you and Matt had to say. I feel like I was just going through back in time, Megan, when you were like, oh, COVID. And I was like, wasn't that just yesterday, it feels like? But I know, Matt, you kind of mentioned just a little bit about like LinkedIn being out. I also wanted to just emphasize that brand awareness is still needs to be a big strategy in your company. So I know we think a lot about when marketing, it's like, oh, we need to like drive MQLs, you know, we need to drive pipeline, and all of that is very true and should be, you know, part of your goals. But you need to have a layer above that. Like, brand awareness is very, very important. Run campaigns that are going to generate eyeballs on your logo and teach people what you do, and like in a very specific and easy to understand way, and who you help with the things that you do. And just to like double click on that a little bit, I also think now we're moving into this age of AI. Like, anyone ever heard of ChatGPT? I know Google just launched Gemini. When you, like, a lot of folks now are using these tools to search for new software, you know, SaaS companies, whatever they're looking for help on. And so you need to make sure that it's in your strategy to improve some of your SEO. So make sure your website has some of the keywords and, like, key terminology and phrases that explain exactly what you do. So these AI tools like ChatGPT and Gemini can pick up on your value adds and your features and your benefits, so that when you're going in and you're searching for, I need a software that powers search for my website, your company can pop up as that, you know, what ChatGPT puts on their list. Google search is still very relevant, but, you know, more folks now are leaning towards these AI platforms and these AI tools, because they're giving, like, ChatGPT and Gemini is giving us a lot more information than Google can. And it's allowing us to ingest that information quicker. So really focus on brand awareness, your SEO on your website, like, messaging on your website. And, like, Megan kind of alluded to this a little bit too, is really make sure that what you are showing your buyers, your potential buyers, on anything that's digital, ads, you know, your website's really important, is very clear and to the point with what you do and who you can help. Another thing I think is, like, I've noticed in the past year that some people are moving a little bit away from is, I feel like we're getting a little lazy on content. We use ads in an okay way, but then we point them to a landing page that's not as relevant. So let's get really clear on a content strategy in 2025. Again, like, outline your messaging, outline your main features, your benefits, who you help, how you help them, and write a content strategy around that. I want to emphasize having strategy in all stages of the funnel. So it's that, you know, top of funnel brand awareness, that's kind of like high level, and then the middle of the funnel, which is going to be more like product features, a little bit more like technical speak around your product and your platform, to meet those people that might know about who you are, or at least know the industry a little bit more. And then also have some content around how folks can get in touch with your sales team and what the benefit of talking to your sales team is. This, I would recommend a very healthy balance of each of these types of content, and really focus on different formats of content. So we have video, we have, you know, advertising, of course, static ads, creative, you have your blogs, you have your long form, your reports. Definitely invest in a team or folks that they are focused on creating and writing this content. So folks, when they come to your website, they can ingest content in the way they want, and you can also promote this content in the way that you want. I've always thought that content is king, and don't get lazy with content, because this is how people learn about your brand, understand what you do, and it also attributes to brand awareness, that SEO strategy that I was talking about, and ideally having folks learn about you and get inbound in a quicker time.
That's a lot to unpack there, and I love it. No, this is good, and I think that, you know, what I'm hearing really from all of this is we're in a place. So 2024 was a lot about, like, speed and how do we hit our goals and how do we hit our metrics and introducing new tools and then just coming out of a bit of a fog. But we're almost in a place where focusing on the signals within the noise is the most important aspect. So Matt talks about LinkedIn being saturated. CR is mentioning searches out in terms of, like, the traditional methods and use of them. It's worth noting, you know, in the last 30 days, we've had 8 SRAs saying, how did you hear about us, through ChatGPT? So I think, like, to resonating on the content, it is so important for us to think about differently. But yeah, it's no longer the spray and pray, put shitty content on LinkedIn, use AI to write content. There has to be some authenticity here, because we can all read through the bullshit. So I love that. Kind of just being mindful of time, we're going to move forward here. I would love to talk a little bit about 2025. So more directly, when it comes to planning for 2025, but H1 for specifically, I don't like to think in annual marketing plans because they're typically trash, but how should companies use historical data and set realistic targets. So Megan, I'd love for you to kind of kick us off by just discussing some of the importance around that, some of the executive conversations you've had, but then, you know, Matt, Ciara, maybe we can just double click a little bit in there. And I have to say, we just need to be mindful of time because we have so many great questions here.
I know. Joey, I'm going to bring you on. So get ready. We're going to have you come on and ask your question. And to this particular question on when it comes to planning, how should we use historical data? I'll maybe touch a little bit on some of the things that you're bringing up in terms of how do you sort of sell, you know, what you believe your marketing strategy should be to an executive team, right? That's a common challenge for any marketer, no matter what you're in. But I'm also curious to dig more into your use case because that always matters depending on your company and your ICP. But zooming out broadly when it comes to planning, this is what I tell, you know, everyone that I speak to. I talked about 7 to 10 marketing leaders per week and really in sales conversations, and I hear the same themes all of the time. And a huge one is, how do we tackle goal setting, and how do we, out of all of the different investments that we could make and all of the different programs, how do we select the right ones? And how do we make that business case to our executive team of why they should listen to us in terms of what the goals should be, what the strategy should be, what the tactics should be, and then, of course, what budget is needed to actually support the execution of that strategy. And so I like to encourage that people basically take two things that are critical for this. It's so important now to take a data-driven approach to everything that you do. So of course, you should analyze all of your historical data and you should evaluate what that data is telling you. The other piece, though, that I wish was more prevalent in everything that we do in life is common sense. So look at your data and analyze, you know, in terms of pipeline creation, closed won, closed lost revenue, what is the data telling you? What programs and lead and pipeline sources are driving the most closed won revenue? What's driving closed lost revenue? When you dig into that, who are the customers that are actually signing? What are trends in terms of firmographic data, industries, segments, employee size? Run a win-loss analysis. Why are you winning? Why are you losing? What is that data telling you? Are you seeing trends in the deals that you're losing? Is that telling you that maybe a certain segment or customer that you thought would buy from you isn't really buying from you and efforts should be directed elsewhere? In terms of what you've already been doing in terms of program spend, whether it's paid advertising or events, conduct some ROI analysis. What is it telling you? How much are you spending on it? How much can you verifiably believe that it is impacting your business in terms of pipeline and revenue? The goal is not that this is a perfect exercise. We all know you cannot measure marketing perfectly, and that's not the goal. The goal is to identify directional trends and insights and conclusions that you can then surface as data-backed evidence that is an input to decisions. It doesn't dictate every decision that is made. Then this is where common sense comes into play. As a marketing leader, the first question I always want to ask is, what is the business strategy? Is our positioning clear? Do we know who our customer is? Is our pricing aligned with what the market is willing to receive? Are we clear on these basic fundamentals? Do we know who we want to reach? Do we know what we want to communicate to them? Do we understand what the offer is? And do we believe that offer is differentiated and compelling enough to attract and acquire that customer? It is critical that if there are gaps in any of those things, I believe it is the responsibility of the marketing leader, the sales leader, you know, anyone on the leadership team to surface those so it can be worked on. It's natural course of business for there to be a lack of clarity or challenges in any of those key fundamentals, and that's okay. What's not okay is ignoring it. So if it is an issue, deal with it and address it. Once you've sort of cleared that and you're taking a look at the data, the big question I ask and I tell people is, your demand strategy can be really simple. Where does your customer spend time? What matters to your customer? And what is it that you need to communicate to your customer to make them aware that you exist, understand what you do, and get clear on the value that you can provide? So when they have a need for a product or a service like yours, they are already aware that you exist and they are clear on the value that you can offer to them. And that is crucial. And with those data points and sort of that sort of common sense business planning, along with any constraints that you get, right? I'm a fan of budget constraints. It actually makes you make better decisions. You have a budget to work with. No one has unlimited resources. What are the most important things that you want to prioritize ultimately to achieve your goal of getting in front of and communicating to your audience effectively to drive action, inbounds, pipeline, ultimately revenue? So we touched on, I tried to like touch a little bit on your question, Joey, but let's get Matt and Ciara and Evan's perspective on this question. And then we have a third prompt, but I'm going to override it. We're going to bring you in after this and have you ask your question live and talk a little bit more about your use case. But Matt, how would you, what do you have to add in terms of when it comes to planning, how should companies use historical data to set realistic targets?
I want to tackle Joey's question. I think it's really interesting, but I think this goes back to what I said earlier, just creating levels of measurement for yourself. And part of that is just building a resilient and scalable measurement framework. So like, I like to break things up through actuals, goals, pacing, efficiency metrics, cost per metrics, payback and velocity metrics. And basically I'm running that at a funnel level. And then that gives me some really good comparative things I can look at. So I'm looking at my high intent funnel, low intent funnel, if I have something like that. And then essentially just by understanding some of the cost pers and everything that go into that, I can look at things with confidence and know if I should do more or less or the same of it, especially when you're looking at against some of your expenditures. So looking at in-platform metrics against CRM dashboards, to me, this isn't all honest data at the end of the day. When you're looking at in-platform metrics, like, do you have it set as like every touch or last touch or anything like that? But I'm looking at in-platform data and I'm more so support the what I'm seeing in the CRM dashboard at the end of the day. And then like if I'm looking at it against my plan, I just want to figure out what went right, went wrong. Where is it breaking? Is it in the lead to SAL? Is it in the SAL to op? Is it like two stage two, something like that? And then other things that I see like when I'm doing goal planning, especially looking at existing ones that I got, there's a couple of just huge red flags that I always kind of look at and I'd have major reticence signing up for. So one of that is escalating pipeline and close one ECVs month over month. Like that's never how it works really in actuality when you kind of look at it against like what really happens. So whenever I see something like that happening, I'm normally a little bit reticent to like look at that and want to sign up for it unless there's going to be an expenditure increase that kind of goes with it. Like, yeah, you'll reach some semblance of scalability on that. But to me, that's always something I usually look at. And then the other thing I like to look at is if like, how much pipeline do I need to close like the revenue goal? So percent of pipeline closed is something that I tend to look at a lot, especially trailing 12 months, last quarter, things of that nature. So I want to see kind of how we're performing historically. And then it gives me a sense of, well, how much pipeline do we need to create in order to hit this goal based on what we've been doing the last 6 months. And that really makes a difference if your ACV or if your close one like varies wildly because of however you guys have pricing structured, like whether it's a usage-based model or a seat-based model or something like that. So when ACVs are all over the place, like I really want to look at percent of pipeline closed. It really gives me a good sense of like what we need to model around that. So those are just some quick snap feedback that I have in terms of how I look at planning. And yeah, that's kind of just first thing I came top of mind there.
Yeah, I agree, Matt. I definitely think about more also like kind of the mix of pipeline. So when I'm thinking about just goal setting in general, the first thing I do is break down my opportunity reports by industry, by company size, by kind of demographic that you have available in your CRM. And I want to see like even job titles, if you can get that data. I want to see who's making it to opportunities, what industries they're in, and what business segment they're in. You know, even regions, if that's something that's important to your business. But I want to know like what is driving the most pipeline from a demographic perspective. And then I straight up map that data to what I'm targeting on various, you know, social channels or just in general with like my targeting strategy for paid media. I also look at, you know, even down to like paid search, like what keywords are folks, you know, searching for and then converting on, and then just making sure that we're optimizing for those keywords, of course, in the strategy. But the biggest thing with like historical data is I really look at the pipeline metrics, and I less look at the mix of closed won, just because from a marketing perspective, we can do a lot more at the top of the funnel to impact like the MQLs and the MQL quality that move to pipeline. Closed one is a little far off for me. So when I think about closed one, I liked it because I want to know like what's driving revenue, but I don't necessarily make actionable strategic decisions from a marketing perspective off of closed one data. There's a lot of things that can impact closed one data. It can be, you know, the seller, the time of year, of course, like what's the business is up to, like their budget. So I really want to look at what's driving folks to a qualified stage in a business, because I care about who actually is the right person that can buy my product, instead of, is this the right time to buy my product? I'm more interested in the who. And so that's what I kind of look at from a demographic perspective. And then I also think self-attribution, self-reported attribution, obviously we talk about this so much, but I do think it's good to have kind of that additional layer. And it's good for a create demand strategy when you are running a lot of brand awareness on social media and your leaders are like, hey, Ciara, I need to know what LinkedIn is directly contributing to my ROI. And you're like, well, actually, I can't give you that direct attribution data because there's so much else that's happening in the market that we don't know about from a dark social perspective. And so giving you direct ROI is actually not going to be what I want to look at from a create demand perspective. I want to look at the self-reported attribution data, kind of like Evan mentioned with ChatGPT. And then I also want to look at just like the total mix of create demand channels and capture demand channels. Are we driving pipeline? And how much money are we spending on marketing initiatives in general? And do just like a higher level ROI analysis between the pipeline, you know, opportunity value, and how much money you're spending on your create and capture demand channels. I know we want to dig into this topic a little bit more. So Megan, maybe it makes sense to bring Joey on and we can tackle this question a little bit deeper.
I want to add to what Ciara said. I love anchoring on a qualified pipeline because it's a really tangible goal that marketers can kind of get around, because it speaks to the leading indicator of inbound and the lagging indicator of revenue. And marketers are much more in control of those leading indicators and that qualified pipeline metric. And then the lagging indicator, it's so much more of a team effort at that point in time. It's like, to Ciara's point, it's the seller, it's the AE, there's macro conditions in the market, no one knows what's going on. Like, we literally have an election in the US next week, so who knows if people want to buy something right now? Like, there's all these macro factors that you literally don't have a lot of control over for close one at the end of the day. And when it comes to like measuring against a dark social, a brand awareness initiative, you have to ultimately look at the incrementality of pipeline growth against the ad spend. Like, that should be the end all be all kind of indicator of that. Like, if you're seeing pipeline grow from an incremental standpoint against the total variable expenditure at the end of the day, and you're seeing enough attribution from self-reported, from in-platform, if you want to add sales reporter attribution or track mentions in Gong calls, if you have something like that. I have something like that with one of my clients where like we get a lot of internet as self-reported because it's not really an ICP that's like on social a lot. So they equate everything that's on the internet with just being on the internet. So I'm just like, okay, well, let's just add a sales reporter attribution field and let's just see what they say then. And we end up getting like that other kind of granular piece of insight to give us support on a couple of things that we're running. In this one particular instance, we're running a big partnership initiative because this company is a big HubSpot partner. And we're essentially promoting out to HubSpot people to refer us to these companies. And we're seeing that populate a lot in the sales report attribution. It's been an interesting partnership play and it's been super successful for us the past few months. So like if you're not getting attribution at the self-reported level, think of another way to extract that information in a way that's not going to be prohibitive for your sales team or your prospect.
Awesome. Thanks, Matt, for the color. Let's get Joey on here.
Awesome. So quick summary, and a lot of what you're saying is resonating. The obsession with our executive team is that the more degrees of separation between what marketing is doing and the outcome, the worse. they become, and we had a similar to what you talked about, the trends. We had a much larger budget. We were a little bit more awareness demand driving a couple years ago. And we cut so much of the awareness budget because they're like, well, if we can't directly tie that we went to this event, met Sam, Sam became an opportunity and Sam closed, and therefore we have a clear ROI calculation, it was out the door. So fine, we adapted. We had a very event-driven, webinar-driven, like very clear list of higher intent leads that we're handing off to the BDR team, like very basic marketing function. This year, I go in with the same request as last year and said, okay, we need to invest in awareness. And these are the types of things that we would want to drive. And it's not going to be directly driving pipeline and saying, we know we spent this and it got us this many opportunities or high intent revenue ops, et cetera. And we are focused, very data-driven focus. We have a very clear funnel, especially on the sales side and the BDRs. We know if we do X amount of calls with this many leads, we're going to get this many close one opportunities. And we love that obsession with the funnel, but I'm begging for some faith that top of funnel awareness driving. We have a great content team that's now churning out content. Nobody's seeing it. Our SEO is pretty nascent. So it's just sitting there on our blog. I'm like, we know what our target audience is. It's extremely narrow. We sell into healthcare and banking for customer communication channel. It's a little bit niche. There's not a clear category, but we have clear competitors. We know the things they care about. We have great differentiators. We're a growing business and we're doing quite well. So it's not that hard to get in front of those audiences on those platforms and show them the thought leadership, show them that we're speaking at these events with really credible people on stages and talking about topics they care about. We're investing so much in making sure we're thought leaders in the space, but nobody's seeing it. So that, and this is, I mean, this conversation happened last week. I'm really struggling, and our COO is my boss, getting him to understand. He actually understands what I'm talking about, driving higher intent leads, driving inbounds, educating the buying team, accelerating the sales cycle, all these things that we're not measuring. It's just SQLs, meeting scheduled for the sales team. And if we're hitting that 83 a month, then marketing is doing their part, even though sales is not hitting their goals. And if you ask the sales leader what they want from marketing, they're not getting it, even though our CEO is going to a meeting and saying, we're killing it. So a lot of the things you're all very familiar with and challenges, obviously happy to answer any more questions that you may have, but curious how you would recommend I approach this challenge.
Matt, I see you chomping at the bit. You go first.
I'm not yet. Like I'm hearing this. It's a lot more color than what I'm getting than what I saw in the type question. And now I want to noodle on it for a minute.
I'll ask a quick follow-up question, Joey, because I think a big key, you mentioned your audience is very niche. Can you talk a little bit more about who is your buyer? And when you say your audience is niche, that can be a challenge in terms of what the strategy should be. And maybe some, best practices that everybody talks about that are applicable to most businesses maybe aren't as impactful if you have a really smaller niche audience that you need to reach. So I think that's like a critical piece of information that we need to know before we can jump to, oh, well, you should do X, Y, and Z. So expand a little bit on sort of your ICP profile.
Yep. It varies a bit by industry, which is a bit of a challenge. But if we're selling into, let's say, consumer banks, we sell into the marketing departments, of course, try to be more executive level, consumer banking, checking accounts, driving adoption of new checking accounts. So there's retail banking, there's consumer VPs of consumer banking or deposits. So there's a couple variation of titles in the banking space, but typically marketing focused. In healthcare, it's also marketing. So marketing executives, the CMO, but then people who are in charge of member engagement, customer communications, and then down to, if we get to like the government programs, that's improving. It's the people who are in charge of quality, the Medicare, Medicaid lines of business, the messaging we have aligned to all these different titles in all of our and outbound and when we go to events, et cetera. But those are the primary titles, and we are very title focused. We are only calling into those departments and then looking for specific titles that we've identified by talking to clients or who makes it to late stage ops. These titles, great. Those are the people we're targeting the front end. I don't know if that, and then in pharma, it's, you know, patient access. If then he was in charge of communicating with the customer. These people are also looking at other text-based solutions, where a text-based solution. So those are some of our competitor landscape is the other secure texting platforms in the space.
Makes sense. And go ahead.
Do you have a subset of like target accounts, like across the business? You just know these are, is it like that niche where it's like, we only can sell into these 400 accounts. This is all we're going to focus on.
It's like 8,000, but it's still pretty narrow. Like we have our like whale hunt focus of the top 20 banks. And then we have, you know, maybe 1,000 banks that are above $1 billion in assets and 50,000 customers. So we have a pretty, and then we do the same for healthcare. There's only like, I don't know, 500 health plans or something like that in the country. Pretty much all of them we could sell into. Pharma's a little bit newer, but it is like no more than 6,000 to 8,000 accounts are we really focused on, but we focus on a, you know, a smaller subset of those and do ABM work against 5,000 to 1,000 of them, 500 to 1,000 of them.
I feel like that's one of them.
Yeah, go ahead.
One of the, you know, that's nice to hear, right? Because I think that's the first challenge most people come into is they don't necessarily have this target account list. But sometimes when you cast yourself so thin, right? And you have 2,000 to 3,000, like, are you really going to make a dent on that? Absolutely not. And you mentioned like you also at one point were, maybe I misheard you, but exploring brand awareness, you were testing this out, and then the kind of the executive team pulled and scaled back. Is that true?
Correct.
Do you see a direct correlation in terms of quality deter after you pulled back that awareness, or did you still have some latency? Did you have enough data to kind of like prove pre and post? And then after that, I'm sure Matt can provide some, and Ciara can provide some other color.
No. And that's one of the things I pitched this year is we need to see this through. We can't do a 2-month test and spend $30,000 on LinkedIn and show that we have like killed it. And we have proven that awareness is important. We had some metrics around, you know, visibility to our blog and people visiting and the right, you know, how targeted our audience was and the accounts that are coming to our site and some of those like leading indicators that it was working, but we didn't have, you know, they're like, where are the inbounds? Well, we didn't have people inbound and we didn't get meetings scheduled. Again, that obsession with where were the meetings. We didn't have any anecdotal like, oh, I had better, this person had seen this article or any self-reported data. So I think the brevity of the test is what really killed us. Yeah. And the same thing, if you're doing like, you know, sponsorships and or direct email to audiences with some of the partners that we work with, things like that. Like we get, you know, this many people opened it, this many people clicked on your link. But, you know, I know, and I think that's where I really struggle is what are the metrics that they're going to care about that is going to connect them to this is going to come down the pipeline. This is going to drive revenue. We have a very clear BDR outbound funnel where if you make 10,000 calls every quarter, that BDR is going to generate 1.5 close one deals by the end of the quarter. And we have 6 BDRs and that's 10 new logos a quarter. Bam, there's our goal. Bringing that level of predictability to something that's not as scientific has been where I'm struggling.
You said you have a lot of great content. Is it very POV driven? Do you guys have like a strong POV or is it more like kind of how to do this, yada, yada?
I'd say POV, like speaking on topics that we know, we have some internal SMEs that will have, you know, write about what's going on in the industry and obviously always tying it back to like customer engagement, as a focus. You know, we always try to make them educational, not just, we need to put content out there. Like here's an SEO optimized article about blah. Yeah. If that makes sense.
Yeah, it feels like maybe on the great demand side, maybe you just haven't found the right mix in terms of the offer yet. So like I have a use case, it's not the exact same, but it took us almost 6 months to really crack this consistently. But I have one use case we sell into surgeons, and surgeons are a very tough nut to crack overall. And they have this company had a list. We knew exactly who these surgeons are. We wanted to target. We matched it. We did a predictive audience as well on top of it. And we started doing a bunch of stuff. We were running brand awareness ads, running static image. They had a lot of subject matter experts who were also surgeons. We were running videos as well. It's like 4 months in and we were just not seeing a lot of in-platform conversions. We weren't seeing a big dent in the inbounds. They score off training requests, things like that, the medical device. So we started to layer conversation ads in after a while. as kind of like the bottom funnel offer and basically replace that with the demo ads. And we started seeing a lot more stuff come through with just the right offer there. And we got the targeting right. And it ended up being like, it ended up working really well. So sometimes when you're not seeing it from like a platform, I don't know if you're running LinkedIn ads in particular, but sometimes like that last sort of ask at the end of the day, maybe that offer is just not quite right, or you haven't found the right ad platform. And I remember we were talking a couple weeks ago, and they had one of the surgeons come to them and say, I never open my email, I never respond to an email ever, email's dead, but LinkedIn's kind of where I go to sort of like just get away from it. And like, you know, got getting that offer from like another surgeon in the space like really resonated with me, and that's why I ended up coming inbound. So sometimes it's just like just not quite having that right mix at the end of the day to sort of show something like really tangible. And once we kind of figured that out, we started to get a lot more confidence in what we were doing and looking to expand it out a little bit more as a result. So sometimes it's not that easy though. Like I'm putting a prescriptive tactical fix to something that may be a bigger sort of issue for you. In terms of your first question about like having to get rid of all this stuff to do a bunch of like sponsorships and webinars and stuff, like I wonder why these things have to be mutual or aren't mutually exclusive, why you can't do both at the same time to a certain level here. Because I do feel like you have to be always on, especially if you know where your audience is at the end of the day. And that thing should actually make those sponsorship motions even stronger for you at the end of the day. You should be able to somehow reasonably split the baby there a little bit to say, hey, let's do both. There's no reason to sunset one thing to go all in on another. And going back to like just the incrementality measurement at the end of the day is kind of what I'd be looking at that against. And then hopefully, you know, you can reason a test of that kind. But just diagnosing it from what I'm hearing, and it sounds like it's a complicated product with a complicated ICP. So there's probably a lot that if I got to look at it straight for a couple of weeks, I'd understand a lot more. But that's kind of just what I'm reading right now. And if I'm way off base, like please redirect me. But that's sort of based on your question and how you're describing it is what I would prescribe a little bit, at least to look at.
That's a great point. I did try to sell it as we're not replacing something by taking 15, you know, dedicating 50% of our budget to this, you know, digital awareness strategy. We're able to do all of the demand that has proven to, you know, deliver this past year while also making a few cuts elsewhere and setting us up to do something like this. And there's still like, oh, well, we could take that 300K and hire an executive. It's just like they're thinking about all the, again, like tangible, it's a person, it's, you know, not necessarily pipeline. So you're 100% right. And that's exactly how I've tried to position. It's going to amplify a lot of the demand gen things that we've been doing that have been working. It's going to help accelerate sales cycles is one of the questions in here. And we don't do anything post handoff other than enablement for things that are in the pipeline. I mean, the AEs have the full responsibility in taking a most often very cold lead that we got to take a meeting through to then pull them through. So our qualified bucket is a graveyard. And you know, they're getting the few that do actually have intent or did maybe see us at an event, et cetera, and pulling those through. But our, things die pretty early on.
Yeah. I'll just offer one note here too, Joey. And also this is like in like kind of relevant maybe to the other folks just trying to figure out how to really drive value behind a brand awareness strategy, I think is kind of just the main topic. Really what like executives care about is the value of my money that I'm allowing my team to spend going up or down? Like what are these dollars going to? And the only thing that like executives right now can think about is like, okay, are we driving pipeline? Are we driving close one revenue? And so it's because that's what they care about at the end of the day. Like we want to make business for the, you know, we want to drive revenue for the business. But I think as like a marketer, it's important that you educate on less about driving the pipeline and more about is the value of the money that you're spending going up. And so how you can do that is if you have a small list or even just a list of accounts, are you reaching more of those accounts at the same amount of money with marketing initiatives? Then you can say, hey, I am reaching these accounts and we are reaching one account at 50% less than we were reaching them 6 months ago. And so I think that's another metric that you should really use to drive a brand awareness strategy and then use, you know, like, I don't know if you're on LinkedIn, Joey, but if you are on LinkedIn, I know like it's a saturated market, but you can see if you're reaching the accounts that you want to reach. And that's a good way to drive that metric of, yeah, we're actually reaching 60% of the accounts now. When we're reaching 40%, we're spending about the same amount of money. We've optimized content. We've, you know, done all these optimizations, and we're spending 50% less to reach one account. And so I definitely would focus more on cost efficiency metrics and less on this like pipeline, you know, till you die type of metric, especially when you're trying to drive a brand awareness strategy.
Really helpful.
Yeah, two reports I would just for the whole audience here. Companies reach report from your LinkedIn reps, if you are on there, is actually a really, really good report to kind of understand and sell this idea that our audience is there, and or maybe challenge yourself to recognize they're not. So it'll provide you, is our ICP reachable? And then are they active on platform? So there's sort of two wins that we'll often pull for clients, is to understand, is this an audience worth exploring and digging a bit deeper? But also I just encourage people to look at the velocity and the sales cycles of stage duration between each of those different sources. So if you're driving through newsletter sponsorships, are those actually qualifying to any MQL or qualified prospect at a faster speed than they were prior? Then that's kind of another layer where you can kind of just peel back to CR and Matt's point, is it's about understanding from top to bottom, what are the influencers, and does that actually show that we're bringing more value to this account faster? And if yes, then, you know, you're kind of setting up the argument in itself. But I want to just be, does that kind of help guide you, Matt, Joey?
Absolutely. I really appreciate everyone's input. Thank you.
Cool. I know we just have a few minutes left as well. I want to open it up to Steph. I'm not sure if other questions that I maybe missed popped in there, but
we've got one from Aaron in the chat right now. A few of them have kind of been answered and addressed as we've gone through, which has been great.
Awesome.
Oh, I see. Aaron's asking, when you're building your 2025 plan and setting goals, how much time thinking should you commit to how the plan impacts the next 3, 5, 10 years. I love that.
Well, can we just talk about Evan's face? He's just like,
That terrifies me, because the average runway for any SaaS company is pretty short, depending on where they are at in their growth stage. Mm-hmm. So it's more about a matter of, I think 3 years, you can look at that, right? And you can set achievable goals, but you have to be realistic of how fast, like SaaS is such a commoditized business as in itself, that it just gets swallowed by other competitors constantly, and AI is influencing that. So it's really just like about solving solutions in year one. Year two, are we able to scale that? And then I think at year three is where it's like, are there product features, adoptions? Are we making improvements to the product that make it scalable? You don't know what your product is today, what it's going to look like in 5 years, because you have to have the market influence that and users.
Yeah, but let's talk about this enterprise segment that I was talking about earlier. I agree with you, Evan, on sort of the startup and the growth stage segment. But Aaron, your question is perfect in terms of, you know, what if you are that, you know, $750 million ARR company that's been around for 15 years and you're trying to surpass $1 billion in the next, you know, 18 months. You have to be thinking in that long-term view. You have to be, once you reach that scale, you need to be making investments for 3 years, 5 years, 10 years out, both from like an R&D and sort of product high level business perspective on how is your product evolving to meet market needs, but of course your go-to-market strategy as well. So how are you investing in marketing and sales as a result of that? I think it's really difficult for marketers today to be in a position to take the time to think long term because of all of the pressure internally to deliver yesterday and tomorrow. So I recognize that. I empathize with that. But for those that are listening or those that are at companies that have reached a larger scale, this is absolutely a way to present a strategy. What I always say is any marketing strategy ideally has both short, medium, and long-term tactics that are going to help with this quarter's number, next year's number, you know, the number from a couple of years from now. So I think that there's a huge variance based on the company and the stage and the scale that you're at. But I love the intent of this question, Aaron, and sort of thinking in the long term.
All right, Stacy took the words out of my mouth, but I mean, it really has to do with the product roadmap at the end of the day. Like, where's the product going to be in 3 years? And then how can we ramp with the product to whatever the ICP or the new industry is going to be? To your point about if you're an established company or a startup company, also, it's just the landscape. Like, are we, you know, a topographic design company who's like creating this whole new space for ourselves, and we're going to sell into big OEM manufacturing? Are we going to be like a collab and we're almost creating our own sort of future here? That's a different roadmap than being, you know, Gong or something like that, where they're basically building up to feels like compete against HubSpot in the future, you know? So like, I think it's just kind of knowing where your company is and it's in its continuum and recognizing where they want to go. Most really established companies like that are like trying to basically build a platform out to go compete against other platforms. Whereas some companies are trying to build like literally the best additive tool to an existing kind of infrastructure that exists and want to own that emerging market. Because if you look at something like, and it depends, like a lot of people are selling to sales and MarTech, but there's other things that are also like growing like leaps and bounds, like additive manufacturing. And there's all these additive manufacturing, and there's going to be all this need for additive manufacturing SaaS at some point in time. And there's so few companies building something like that. I'm bringing my industrial background into the mix here. So part of it is just knowing where your company stands in the landscape of your customers and the competitive landscape, and then being able to ramp your future around where that roadmap and that market's going to be in your estimation.
As the perfect close. Appreciate it, Matt. Ciara, Megan, Matt, thanks for joining. Everybody that also joined us today, like, we wanted to just have authentic conversations with the community. We want to keep your questions coming. This is just, we have two more sessions this quarter, so be sure to register those. We'll send the recap out, but yeah, we'd love to hear feedback too. We want to make sure these are valuable for everybody. So don't hesitate to email us, DM us directly on LinkedIn. Just let us know how you felt the conversation was, what could be better. We're always looking to improve, but yeah, with that, we'll kind of sign off and say thanks for joining.
It was so good to see everyone. I hope to see you back again at our event next month, and have a great rest of the day, great rest of the week. Keep fighting the good fight.
Bye, everyone.